Nice to see you.
Mr. Chairman.
Washington correspondent.
Well, won't you come in?
You've done the magazine review of Signal Honor by agreeing to see us so shortly after such a long stay.
Well, I'm pleased to do it.
Thank you very much, sir. You're looking remarkably good after your journey.
Well, I'm testimony to that new handling of jet lag that the doctor who has written a book about it, you know?
It does work.
It does work. We practiced it, and I must say, came through the trip very well.
Certainly better than I did flying from Hong Kong, I'm sure.
I know what you mean, because I could practice it going, but then in the sudden turnaround to come home, I couldn't. So it was coming this way that was the worst.
Well, we are deeply grateful to you, particularly, as I said, so shortly after your return. We have put the questions to you, and I gather that the answers have been pretty well drafted.
Yes.
So I wondered whether you'd mind, Mr. President, if I asked just a couple of general questions.
Fine.
First of all, the trip. How would you sum up its achievements and how you feel after this, seeing the leaders of China?
Well, we all feel very good about the trip, and I do particularly. Granted, there are the differences between us and our different styles of government, kinds of government and all, and yet there was a friendliness, and we found in both they and we had the same idea that the things that were important were not the differences, but the things that we had in common. They are as opposed to expansionist policies as we are, to attempting to dominate or have hegemony over other areas of other countries. We made it plain to them that we respected their non-aligned situation. They're very serious about wanting to be non-aligned, and we agreed with that, but said that that didn't mean that we could not work together on things as two independent countries with the same interests. And I happen to be a believer in the Pacific Basin as the place of the future. I think this is the man in our own country who said, go west, young man. Well, we're still going west. And I think that between us, as the two biggest, the United States and China, we can contribute a great deal to a stability in the whole Pacific Basin and in Eastern Asia. And the fact, the changes that they're making in their modernization, their welcome to outside capital investment and all, it was pretty unusual after recent years to go in and actually go through a plant that was a partnership between a Massachusetts company and the People's Republic, to know that they have also now opened up to investment of outright foreign concerns or industries coming in there without partnership, being totally owned. And it was a most successful trip. We found ourselves in great agreement on so many things.
They're coming closer towards our way of life, are they?
Well, in the sense of believing in incentive for the people, we visited, the last day we were there, we visited what a few years ago was a commune, you know, the agricultural thing. Now they call them townships, and they are set up as virtually a township with an autonomous government, local control and all, their own schools and all of this, but also set up so that there is a quota that they must meet in their production that goes to the government. But over and above that, they can sell privately in the marketplace. And we were in the home of a young couple, a young man and his wife and son and his father and mother living with them. It's a new home, he had built it. And he spoke of how they were able to save money just as sounded very American until I had the wherewithal to do this, and then told us of what he was saving for in the line for further furnishings of the home.
Right.
And it their modernization, I think, is going to have a great impact.
Japan must obviously play a part in this whole Pacific idea. Do you think, when you said go west, young man, you repeated that quotation, do you think you as a Californian have a more positive view of the Pacific than, say, the eastern seaboard, which tends to look still towards the Atlantic?
Oh, I think that's only natural. Yes, in the western states there, we started our trip with a visit to Washington, state of Washington, the lumbering industry there, and much of their foreign trade, in fact, as far as I can see, all of it is across the Pacific with the West. Yes, we do have that. It doesn't mean in any way that we downgrade our alliance or our participation in the North Atlantic Alliance, and actually our parentage, you might say, is basically European, but you can't help but feel that great Pacific basin there with all the nations and all the potential for growth and development, that is the future.
Mr. Davies, I think we're cutting into the Vice President's time.
Well, the Vice President's time. Well, you talk about parentage, so I'm a Welshman. They say the Welsh are the Irish that couldn't swim, so I said something.
Well, the next trip, not too long from now, starts in Ireland.
Right. Right. Sir, I must thank you very much indeed. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much.
And I know a little something about Wales, because in 1948, I visited there. I was making a picture in England, and then was there for the command performance. And then we went up to Cardiff, Wales, and I can still remember the mayor of Cardiff saying to us in greeting, and when you return to London, or when you return to your own country, don't say that you were in England, say you were in Wales.
Right. There's quite a bit of nationalism around there, sir.
Yes.
Thank you very much.
Well, it was good to see you.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you.
That's right. Yeah, the idea is that about 5 minutes to 12 or thereabouts, people are supposed to be praying all over the country, so I just consider that the case.
Yeah.
All right. Very good. All right. Have a good trip to Camp David. I probably won't see you before you take off, but unless you have anything for me.
I guess we're rushing because they say there's some storm we're trying to be.
So, you have any? I missed this morning. I was at, you know, Bill Webster's wife passed away.
Yes.
I went to the memorial service. That's why.
Called him.
Good. Anything that you have that I don't know?
No, there wasn't anything on the docket this morning in here.
Then I will see you next on Monday after you've had a little chance for a rest.
Okay.
All right. See you later.
This is Coach Robinson coming in here, sir.
Yes.
Going to catch up with Bear Bryant here shortly.
Yes, he is. Yeah, I've been looking forward to this.
There are a lot of congressmen that are going to come in with him, sir. Trent Locke's coming in, Rob Livingston, and some more. Jerry Duffy, Senator Long, and Senator Johnson, I think, are also going to be there. Okay, bring them right up forward.
10 seconds.
Hi, Coach. Hey, listen, it's good to see you and to meet you. I know we've talked, but this is the first chance to. It's nice to see you.
It's really is. And you said you're looking well.
Mr. President, from Carolyn, England. I'm president of the D.C. chapter of Grambling Alumni.
Well, nice to see you.
Thank you.
And I'm Faye. I'm national president of the Alumni Association.
Well,
how are you?
Good to see you.
I'm president of the Senate branch of
Grambling Alumni.
Congratulations on your extraordinary.
Well, thank you very much.
Yeah, thank you for keeping us to have a great state of Louisiana, right?
looked forward to this for a long time, and not just because congratulate you on the 300 games and where you're going, but your record, and not only with turning out great football players and football teams, but you have had a great concern for what more than football the young men are going to do with their lives. I was fortunate enough to play for a coach who also said that he judged his success not on us as football players, but on later in life seeing us and finding out what we have done with our lives. And I know that that's the way you coach.
That's correct, and I know he's proud of you like we are. As you said, whenever they excel in their chosen profession, we are. We want them to be good Americans.
You have another of that kind, the basketball coach who just won the title out here.
That's right.
You know, we actually had we wanted him to come in, we wanted to congratulate the team, and everything. We had a hard time arranging a time because he wouldn't let them cut the classes.
Well, Mr. President, I judge from what we read in the paper, you were quite pleased over your visit to China.
Yes, I think we had a good and a fruitful trip there.
Your jet lag.
Well, I'll tell you this, and I highly recommend this if you ever have any cross country trips or anything with your teams. This doctor that has written a book about conquering jet lag. As a matter of fact, even our airborne troops use it, the ones that might, you know, have to suddenly go half the world and so forth. Mm-hmm. He has starts with a few days of a particular diet before you go. And I must say, we followed his schedule and arrived in China on their time. The only thing is we didn't have an opportunity to do that for coming home.
Coming
back, we're suddenly, you know, right now it's the middle of the night over there. But, listen, I wanted to ask you a question, though. Did you ever by any chance run across or know a man who he coached down in North Carolina for a while, and then he became the athletic director of Morgan State, Franklin Burkhart?
I know him.
You knew Burkhart?
I knew him.
Well, I'll tell you, Bergie and I were down in the center of the line, and I was right guard, and he was center. We played side by side for 3 years together. He was a year behind me in school. And then he was like the captain of our team at Eureka College the year for his senior year. But we were very close friends, and I had the pleasure of having him here at the White House. He lived here in the East then, of course, at Morgan State. And just a few years later, he died. And a few months later, he died. And he was having an operation and had a massive heart attack. But he was a great guy. Mr. Red's football player.
I remember you and your football fam. I was either the Gipper or Snakehead Scott. It was the Gipper. Mr. President, I'd like to tell you that I've had a lot of thrills, and I guess this is a real high point in my career to have the opportunity to meet and talk to the president of this great nation. It certainly means a lot to me.
Listen, I'm pleased and honored to have you in here.
Well, thank you. I'm going to really be a hero at home. When I got the call, my grandkids were standing by, and they were trying to ask me what you were saying. But later the next day, some of the kids left the elementary school and came over to say, Coach, we want to find out if Mike, that's my grandson, is telling the truth. He said that he talked to the president a Sunday. I said, well, I did. Well, when I walk by the elementary school, I'm a hero, they say, he's talked to the president.
Here's a little souvenir, a pair of cufflinks with the presidential seal. And ladies, a pin with the same
Thank you. Thank you. Yeah.
Cherish this.
So you can prove that you were here.
Thank you. Now, Mr. President, from the Tigers at Grambling, they sent you a gift. They sent you a gift. Well, I know they're going to be proud if they see that.
I'm very, very proud to have that. And having been a sports announcer,
I know a lot about your career.
I'm familiar with the Grambling football. Okay. Well, thank you very much.
Thank you, sir. All right. And it's certainly nice. Bye.
Congratulations again. And go for those other 18 now.
And God bless you.
God bless you.
It was kind for you to give us this time.
When I see you on the street, I want to see you with that t-shirt on.
Okay.
Thank you so much, Brad.
Thank you, Mr. President.
Mr. President, we hope you have much to do.
I see you, sir. What a great pleasure. I'm standing here.
I want to help.
Well, that's because I compete with this guy. I'll tell you. Nice to see you, ma'am.
I'll show you the postman around. I'll make it.
Thank you, Mr. President.